So today Marie will be speaking about the development of subjective and objective tools to measure acute and chronic fatigue. So I'll hand it over to you now.
Hello. So this fatigue research goes back a long, long way, although more recently I've been looking at chronic fatigue syndrome and fatigue in other conditions. It all started long, long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. So we all know what fatigue is, and this is the thing. We all experience fatigue in some way or another, but it's how we perceive it that's different from person to person. And this is why it's been a little bit of a conundrum about how you can actually subjectively and objectively measure it. And I'm sure if Elaine is there, or if she's not, if she listens to this, she'll say the same thing about things like pain as well. And another one is quality of life. How do you measure it? Because it does mean different things to different people. And it's the subjectivity of it that causes a problem. But we do know that there are two components of fatigue, mental and physical. So probably the most recognized version is lack of sleep. Okay, so we all know what it's like, you know, mentally and physically if we don't sleep. And people talk about tiredness or lethargy, not being able to concentrate, a slowing of physical responses, problems remembering things, and not being able to pay attention to things for overextended period, and also a lowering of mood. So in 1993, I know, do we remember 1993 when I was working at the Health Psychology Research Unit at Cardiff University School of Psychology? We started looking at what sleep deprivation can do to human mood and performance during the day and night. Student population, we used 24 students, 12 male, 12 female, and we had four testing sessions over an 8-hour period. So there was a daytime testing period of 8 hours and a nighttime period of 8 hours. What we used a subjective rating of alertness, and then objective measures of verbal reasoning, somatic processing, variable four period simple reaction time, which I'm going to call SRT from now on, and a 5-point serial response task. Each participant completed the day and night sessions, and they had a day's rest in between. And I've got to say, you know, I know this is just sort of being anecdotal about these times in the past, but it was great fun doing all of these experiments. The students loved doing them. We didn't mind being around them for long periods of time. We kept them amused and things like that. So they were able to choose a video that they wanted to watch and things like that. They weren't allowed to go to sleep. That was the most important thing. So what we found in this preliminary type research was that there was, if you think about alertness, there was a significant effect of time of testing, day versus night. So what we found was, as you probably would expect, that as the sessions went on, so when we got to session 3 and 4, then the alertness was definitely falling off. Again, for the SRT, which is a sort of motor speed response reaction time, again, there was an effect of time on testing, day versus night, so they were more able to complete the task during the day than the night, and especially, again, it dropped off, their performance dropped off as the sessions went on, so session 3 and 4. Again, for the serial response task, again, there was a difference between the day and night testing, and again, it dropped off over the sessions. What was interesting was that verbal reasoning and semantic processing were not affected by the sessions or the day and night. So this is sort of a process of elimination. So obviously these sorts of tests aren't really, they're not being changed. So there are specific processes that are being affected by long time day or night working. We also associate fatigue with things like upper respiratory tract infections, or ERTIs as they're called. And the most common is the common cold and influenza. So people who've got a cold often say they have headache, fever, coughs, or throat, but also report feeling sluggish and out of sorts for a week or so. And this usually just persists for a short time after the primary symptoms have resolved. So in a study funded by the Health and Safety Executive and the Economic and Social Science Research Council, we decided to look to see if we could measure this change in fatigue in people with upper respiratory tract infections. Mainly this was the common cold, I have to say. And this time we wanted to know how it affected people over the working day. So if you had an upper respiratory tract infection, how would that change your performance over the day? So we had 21 members of the university administrative staff, 8 men and 30 women, and we had a study length of 10 weeks. So the testing schedule, obviously we can't do what we did with the students, we can't get them to come and stay all day with us. So what we did was we obviously wanted to make sure that they had a working day. So they came before work at 8:30, and they came again at lunchtime, and again after work at 5:30. And for baseline data collection, all the participants completed it, and they all were healthy at the time. And we used mood, but this time we had alertness, anxiety, and hedonic tone. The SRT, the 5 choice serial response task, and a visual search task. So if a participant developed a cold, they contacted the research unit and they completed a cold and flu symptom checklist. Then they completed the mood, the SRT, the serial response task, and the visual search tasks. If they did not develop a cold or flu over the 10-week period, they were retested and acted as healthy controls. So the post-study analysis revealed that there was, that the two groups, the cold and participant group, did not differ from the healthy controls in terms of age, gender, or intelligence. And as expected, the cold and flu group reported greater levels of symptoms than the controls. And we actually found that the symptoms were generally worse in the morning. So when we looked at these two groups, there was a significant effect of colds and flu on compared to the healthy controls. So the colds were less alert and more anxious at each time point, so each of the 3 time points. And also there was a significant effect of time. So as the day went on, the impairment got worse in both groups, as you would probably expect during a working day, but it was significantly different between the colds and the healthy. When we looked at hedonic tone, again, there was a significant effect of colds and healthy at each time point, but there was no effect of time, so there wasn't a difference as the day went on, the hedonic tone stayed the same. For the performance, what we call performance tasks, there was a significant effect of colds and flu on reaction time, so they had slower reaction times at each time point during the day, but also the difference between the two groups increased over time, so there was a divergence. Obviously you're going to perform better, worse as the day goes on, as you get more tired from the working day, but the divergence between the two groups became even bigger. Again, with the serial response task, there were fewer responses from the colds group, and this was significant, but there was no effect of time, so it didn't get any worse over time compared to the health controls. And for the visual search task, we drew a blank there. So the visual search task didn't show any differences between the colds and the healthy, and there was no effect of time. Again, getting rid of another piece of information that might not be of any use in future measurements or any discussions about what functioning might be going on and what functioning is impaired with colds and flu. So I just want to return you to the study I first talked about, which was the 5 testing sessions over an 8-hour period. I actually didn't tell you the full story. This was actually an investigation into the effects of coffee on alertness and performance during the day and night. And it was funded by the Psychological Effects of Coffee Research Fund, which is a great sounding research arm. So this is what we were actually trying to do. We were trying to see if we could reverse any of the impairments in performance over the day and night using caffeine. So in addition to the participants, as I described earlier, they also were randomly assigned to either caffeinated coffee, and there were two different doses, one to equivalent of one cup of coffee and another dose which was equivalent to two, decaffeinated coffee or juice. And the drinks were provided at four time points across the study. So we used an analysis of variance to distinguish between the beverage, whether it's day and night, where they were within the session of the shift, the order of the beverage, and the dose of caffeine. So there were no order effects of the order of beverage. So it didn't matter whether they started off with the caffeine and ended up with something else, or so there were no order effects in terms of the beverage. It didn't make a difference to the participants. And there was no effect of the dose of caffeine. So the two cups of coffee was no different from one. So that sort of rules out, again, another thing, do you have to have a high dose of caffeine to make these performance effects work? So in alertness, there were greater alertness effects following the caffeine at all time points. So obviously the people were more alert after they'd had a coffee. Alertness reduced at night, which we kind of expected. Again, and we saw that before without the coffee. So especially at 3 and 4, so we said at 3 and 4, sessions 3 and 4, it especially dipped then. But the introduction of caffeine returned the nighttime alertness, session 3 and 4, to the daytime levels, so that they were actually going back to their daytime performance, which is obviously very interesting. Well, it is to me. If we think of the SRT, so this reaction time, it was slower at night, as we expected. And again, as we said, I said before, the 3rd and 4th testing session was a problem. And caffeine improved reaction time for all time points when compared to the decaf and juice. When we think of the serial response task, there was an effective time on testing. And the caffeine improved correct responses at all time points when compared to the decaf and juice. And there was a significant difference for drink versus session, with the caffeine effect being overall 4 sessions. So it's improving performance across the 4 sessions. So verbal reasoning, performance task was improved in the caffeine condition. And in semantic processing, caffeine improved the speed of performance for both day and night conditions. So we're getting some interesting pieces of information about the effects of caffeine objectively on mood and performance. I hope you're all still with me, by the way. So what did this add to the literature? So this was just the beginning of something that became much, much bigger. And there was also a bit of an argument going on between the professor at Cardiff University and the professor at Bristol, where they were talking about what was the effect of caffeine. Was it a withdrawal effect, or was it an enhancing effect? And they used to have this argument back and forth and argue at conferences and things like that. But what it did do is it looked at how human performance is impaired by shift work. So it did fit into the occupational side of things and the pros and cons of shift work. So it began to talk about that. And again, far more studies were done on that later on. How caffeine might be used to improve human performance. And again, that's still being talked about now. And it started to look at the possible biological processes involved. So what was the underlying brain neurotransmitter type processes involved? I jumped off this caffeine research, I was going to say merry-go-round, but that sounds terrible, at that time, to move on to other things. But it was continued, and there's some very interesting, if anyone's interested in how this developed into neurotransmitter involvement, etc., then there's a lot of research there that talks about, right up until 2013, that's talking about how these, what might be going on, what the processes are going on with that. So, okay, caffeine works for day and night. Will it work for the common cold? So that was another question. Again, another lovely funder, the Institute for Scientific Information on Coffee. Great. So this time we had 100 students. So we used administrative staff last time, if you remember, but this time we needed a greater number of people. So we had 100 students. And 35 were assigned the caffeinated condition, 32 to the decaffeinated condition, and 33 to the juice condition. And again, it was a 10-week process. If they didn't get a cold, then they acted as healthy controls. And just to say as well, you know, I know it's probably obvious, but we did these during the winter, obviously. We did them, you know, sort of, yeah, during the winter, so in the cold and flu season. So the participants were given a 500ml drink, which is like a cup of coffee, for each condition. Now, this time, we've become more sophisticated at this point. So instead of using decaf and caf and juice, we actually used decaf. But the caffeinated one had 1.5 milligrams per kilogram body weight of caffeine tablets, which, of course, were Pro Plus at the time. Okay, in the later caffeine studies, just to say, they were using liquid caffeine, actually. We weren't all crushing up Pro Plus tablets, which is what we were doing. Schedule of testing, they completed questionnaires, measures of personality traits, health-related behaviours, so alcohol consumption, smoking and diet, and stress, so life events, perceived stress, and negative mood. For the performance tasks, so they did the mood task, alertness, anxiety, and hedonic tone. And then the psychomotor tasks of SRT, the five choice serial response task, and we introduced the pegboard task for this one as well. For memory, we used free recall, logical reasoning, semantic processing, and delayed recognition memory. And there was an order of these, so they did mood twice. They did mood, free recall, the motor tasks, delayed recognition, and then mood again. So that would also see whether there was a performance deficit across the whole testing schedule. So the baseline measures were collected for all healthy, because they were all healthy, and it was collected in the morning between 9 and 11. So we didn't want any time of day effects, because we saw that in the last study, that there were time of day effects with colds. So we wanted to make sure we caught them all at the same time. If they developed a cold, they would come back and they would repeat their session at the same time as the baseline. They were asked to abstain from consuming caffeinated drinks 2 hours prior to testing. And then they were given their second drink once they completed that first set of testing. And then they commenced their second session of testing an hour after the drink, or an hour after the first session, but they had the drink on to me. So again, like I said, 10-week study, those who didn't get a cold acted as healthy controls. So just to check that the participants were all homogenous, so they didn't differ in terms of demographics, personality, stress levels, and health-related behaviours. So in the pre-drink condition, okay, we're looking at the effects of colds. So we know that a repeat of the last time, those with the colds were less alert, more anxious, and had lower hedonic tone, both pre- and post-performance mood. So the first mood and the second mood, they have risen impairments there. So we also found that those with the cold performed more slowly on the two psychomotor tasks. But there was no effect of the colds on the pegboard task, the manual manipulation task. And there was no effect of colds on any of the memory tasks. So the post-drink effects. So all of the effects that we found pre-drink still were still significant at post-sessions, and there were no new effects that were significant. The main effect of drink, the only main effect on the drink conditions was that caffeine produced faster reaction times than the other groups. So when we look at the colds versus drink interactions, we found that there was interactions between colds and drinks for post-performance ratings, so for the response task and the serial response task. And those with colds that were given caffeine returned to a similar level to the healthy participants. And we also found, quite interestingly, and this could be a placebo effect, there was some indication of the benefits, especially on motor speed, for those with colds, even in the decaffeinated group. So that was quite interesting, unless there's some stray caffeine getting in there. This we are talking about quite a while ago, maybe they weren't filtering the caffeine out properly, or it could just be probably a placebo effect. So again, we were able to provide the literature with information of objectively being able to measure impairments in cold and flu, and how caffeine can be used to improve human performance. And it was studies like these that did lead to the inclusion of caffeine in over-the-counter cold and flu remedies. So there was an interest in the pharmacological effects of caffeine, and that's why it started to become included into, I'm not just saying it's just us, there was a few groups doing it, but it was one of the things that led to that. So we've talked about acute fatigue and how we might measure it. So we know that that sleep, rest and stimulants such as caffeine can mitigate the cognitive deficits. But we also know that there are cases where fatigue is ongoing. The etiology is unknown and it's not resolved by sleep or rest. And of course, chronic fatigue syndrome fits this particular scenario. Now, I am going to call it chronic fatigue syndrome. Okay, I know that that's not always the best way of, you know, CFS-ME is what it's sometimes called as well, but I am going to call it chronic fatigue syndrome. So just to give you a little bit of information, this is a tiny bit of information about what is chronic fatigue syndrome. So the CDC, Center for Disease Control and Prevention criteria in 1994 discussed it as being of over 6 months direct duration. There had to be a substantial functioning impairment. Four symptoms are required. Cognitive or neuropsychiatric symptoms may be present, and it had to be of new onset. So what they were saying was, in terms of new onset, is it suddenly or relatively quickly started to become fatigued. So it wasn't because of getting older. We all get more fatigued as we get older. Amen to that. But it had to be a sort of a new onset. So the person could say, I know when this started. So when I jumped off the caffeine and colds research, I jumped onto, sounds like a bit of a frog, the Cardiff Chronic Fatigue Syndrome Project, which was a very long project, which was funded by the Limbury Trust and the Gatsby Foundation. The Limbury Trust is actually one of the Sainsbury's trusts. And at the time, Lord Sainsbury's daughter had been diagnosed with chronic fatigue syndrome, and the Limbury Trust and the Gatsby Foundation were pouring a lot of money into not just medical or clinical research, but also into other aspects of research. It was a fabulous project. It was an interdisciplinary project. I got to meet some fabulous, fabulous people. So it was the Health Psychology Research Unit at Cardiff University, which is where I worked. The Department of Medicine at the University Hospital of Wales, which is now called Cardiff University, it's merged with Cardiff University. The Department of Psychological Medicine at the University Hospital of Wales, psychiatrists were coming from there. The Department of Virology, because they wanted to look at any underlying viral impairment. And the Department of Physiotherapy, which is where eventually a treatment regime was developed. Just to give you a little bit of background about why we did this, okay, and why it was important to the literature. In 1990, and published in 1991, there was an Oxford Consensus meeting. And it gathered together medics, psychiatrists, psychologists, scientists, and researchers to try and decide the direction of research for this chronic fatigue syndrome, which was starting to become quite a problem in primary care. So it set out the parameters for CFS research in the UK. So two of the leads on the project was Professor Andy Smith, who's still at Cardiff University, and Professor Sir Boris Avovich, who was the head of medicine at the time, but is now at Cambridge. And what they did was they set out different groups to do different things. So they asked the psychiatrists to do certain things, the medics to do certain things, the psychologists to do certain things, the scientists and researchers to do other things. And we were tasked with investigating the role of psychosocial factors and recurrent infection. Okay, so that was the bit of the virologist, and also to provide healthcare evaluation and the assessment of patient education in CFS. So the participants were consecutive referrals to a specialised outpatients clinic, and they were asked if they would agree to join the research panel. Now, in the beginning, the actual outpatient clinic was being funded by the Limbury Trust, so it wasn't an NHS clinic to start with because the NHS didn't have the resources to use the clinic. The reason why the NHS wouldn't have resources to do it was because they were only seeing four patients per clinic morning. So you can imagine that's not a cost-effective way of running a clinic, but because so little was known about it, there was a lot of research going on, and only four participants came at a time. So you can imagine how long it was to recruit participants. So the original, there was an original cohort of 67 volunteers. And I, you know, it's sad to say, and I'm sure probably ethically wouldn't be very sound now, but we basically threw the psychological kitchen sink at them. We made them do various performance tasks, not just the ones I've shown you, but a lot of performance tasks, a lot of questionnaires, because really no one knew what was going on and what was underlying this condition. And they did do, and I hate to say this, they did do 2 hours with us in the health psychology research unit. They actually came to the unit after they'd been to the clinic, you know, they made another appointment. And so, yeah, we did rather do that to them. Obviously, after we found out in, you know, basic analysis, we found which ones weren't going to be any use anymore. We got rid of all of a lot of them, and we ended up recruiting in cohort one and the second cohort, 307 volunteers. The ratio was 3 to 7, mean age 42. And we also recruited a control group who were gender age matched, and we recruited them through newspaper advertisements. So what did we want to look at when we started doing it in a smaller style testing schedule? So we obviously wanted to look at demographics, diagnosis and treatment information. We looked at subjective measures. There were more, but I'm just going to talk about a few of them. So the profile of fatigue, which looks at fatigue, emotional distress, somatic symptoms and cognitive difficulties. We created a symptom checklist. We looked at sleep quality, cognitive failures, and anxiety and depression. And then for the objective measures, we pared them right down. So we looked at the mood, alertness, anxiety, and hedonic tone. We looked at free recall, and we used the performance tasks of response times. And a new one, the repeated digit vigilance task, which is one of the most horrible tasks to do in the whole world, and Stroop. So what we've basically done is got our testing schedule down to approximately 15 minutes, depending on the person having to rest or take a break and things like that. So the word interference task, and I should have put a reference there, very sorry. So what we got was the subjective measures, there were significant differences between the chronic fatigue and the control group, the fatigue, symptom checklist, sleep quality, cognitive failures, anxiety and depression. And in the objective measures, again, there was a significant difference between their mood, memory, and performance. And the reason that we chose some of these measures was because anecdotally, people with chronic fatigue, when they were talking about their cognition, they were talking about forgetting things, not being able to remember phone numbers, not being able to concentrate on a book, So they would start reading a passage and they would read it again and again. They would lose the plot lines of films. And you know, when I talk about chronic fatigue syndrome, the impairments that these people had were really significant. And often, you know, they would come to the clinic and they would be in tears just because someone believed them. And it was quite a humbling experience to work with these people over a number of years, because they really did worry about their sanity, especially if they didn't have very good primary healthcare, and they didn't believe them, which I found that that was true in some research as well. So, you know, they did talk about things that were a problem. They didn't have the joie de vivre that we have because they didn't, they weren't able to do the sort of normal things that we find really interesting. Forget about the major things, you know, not being able to hold down a job, things like that. So why was this important, this piece of information? It was really important because there'd been contention in the research about whether there was cognitive impairment that could be measured in this patient sample. But I can actually go woohoo with this one, because we were the first group to objectively demonstrate impairments in this condition. So since then, people have had to take away that, because what they were saying is, yeah, subjectively they say this, this, and this, but objectively we don't know. So we managed to do that, which was a really great achievement, one of my greater achievements up to now. And we were able to prove that, not only subjectively, but objectively, they were measuring quite accurately their performance. And we actually use these measures because, okay, it's all well and good collecting this data, but what else would we do with it? So what we wanted to do was to longitudinally look at these patients, so look at their recovery over time, because at the time there was no treatment available. I also looked at the efficacy in a retrospective analysis of antidepressant medication, and we did do a treatment efficacy type trial. So in terms of efficacy in antidepressant medication, as I say, it's retrospective, but we did find that antidepressant medication that had been prescribed before they attended the clinic did improve their chances of recovering over time. But I can hear you all shouting, self-selecting group. Yes, they were a self-selective group. It was retrospective, and of course not a trial, but it might be the case that those who could tolerate antidepressants did better, but a lot of chronic fatigue patients can't tolerate antidepressant medication. In recovery, we found that recovery in the untreated patient was very small. It was improved by antidepressant medication, but they would only 10% of them recovered over 3 years. Treatment efficacy, I'm going to talk a little bit about now, but if you want to read more about the other two parts of it, there's the papers there. So the treatment was cognitive behavior therapy and graded exercise. And I just read with interest that NICE, in their new CFS guidelines, have now removed graded exercise therapy because they don't believe it actually does anything. And what we found when we used this, what we called multi-convergent therapy, it was developed by a physiotherapist at the University Hospital of Wales, Mike Sadlier. And we found that 10 sessions of CPT graded exercise therapy improved their fatigue, their symptom checklist, their anxiety, depression, and sleep. We also found improvements in their objective measures of condition. So another woohoo. And we found that, yes, these were immediate post-therapy effects. They continued 6 months after the therapy, so they didn't have any intervention after that. So it was a one-off shot deal. And we also found that 3 years post-therapy, they were still finding there were positive effects of having had that particular therapy. Now, again, contentious, you know, CBT, contentious. in the CFSME groups, but we did find that. And what was lovely about that was, but slightly annoying, was after the MCT group had finished the 6 month therapy, I started getting postcards from them saying that they'd gone on holiday for the first time and things like that. But some of them had gone back to working part time. Some of them were doing voluntary work. And it was the person sending the postcards really annoyed me by the end. But you know, they sent, and when they came back to see me after 3 years, they were absolutely, they couldn't say speak highly enough of it. And that was just, again, it was just a fabulous experience. Okay, I've jumped off that one now, leaving that to other people. But also, you know, so we've used it for chronic fatigue syndrome, the measures that were sort of started being developed in the caffeine and the day-night stuff. Could we use the CFS project measures in other chronic conditions? And in my last job, I worked in a developmental disorders assessment centre, which was part of the university. And one of the big reasons that that had been developed was because of developmental coordination disorder. So there was a lot of work being done with ASD, dyslexia and ADHD. But developmental coordination disorder was sort of the Cinderella of the developmental disorders or the neurodevelopmental disorders. What the clinicians were finding is that adults with DCD were complaining of fatigue. And I thought, you know, I had my light bulb thing again, and decided to do a survey with the chronic fatigue measures, looking at developmental coordination disorder. Again, a lot of adults who joined it, so the Dyspraxia Foundation was involved with recruitment. They were very interested that I was interested, because they you know, they managed to deal with a lot of the problems that they had with their coordination by either avoiding things or practicing things, but the fatigue wasn't going away, and that was being quite problematical for them. And we did find that there were some similarities, but some differences. And one of the interesting thing was, is in the clinic and when I, in the survey, there were also people who'd had a dual diagnosis of developmental coordination disorder and chronic fatigue syndrome, which should not be possible. One should cancel out the other, but that did happen. And in fact, 14 people who did the study out of 53, well, it was 53 in the end, but another 14 of them had a dual diagnosis. Couldn't do anything with their analysis. Obviously, it was too small, but they did seem to be having a double whammy there. And that could be the stigma of the diagnosis. We don't know about that. I've also used the same questionnaires to look at Parkinson's disease. So when I was writing my book, bit of a plug, about fatigue in healthcare, I did some research into other conditions, and there are a lot of conditions that say that there's an underlying fatigue, which is nothing to do with the primary disease. So Parkinson's disease is one, multiple sclerosis is another, early onset or early stage cognitive impairment. I can't think of the other, well, arthritis is one, but I didn't use them. But there are several different groups that actually say that fatigue, apart from their primary condition, is really very debilitating. So I'm waiting to draft a manuscript with that. So I've got the data. I just need to draft a manuscript, and I talk about the comparisons between these and the chronic fatigue patients. So just to sort of bring it up to date, so in the medical history of the condition, chronic fatigue syndrome is called lots of things, but one of its nomenclatures was post-viral fatigue syndrome. We all know where we're going with that. So currently, I'm waiting for ethical approval for my survey again. So it's the same as the DCD and the Parkinson's disease survey, but obviously I've had to add a lot of stuff into there. What we know about COVID already is about demographics, about ethnicity, about symptoms, about treatment. So what are the underlying conditions? So it's quite a huge demographic portion of the survey. So, you know, so that I can see if I can get enough participants to say, is there a difference between different groups? So using the subjective measures from the Chronic Fatigue Project, and I've got support, which is great. There's a group called the Long COVID Research Group. I've been in touch with them and they're very excited about the whole thing. And they have got 25,000 members, participant members in their group. Across the world, so not just in the UK, so obviously I've also had to include which continent do you live on, and involved, which is the participating in research group are involved as well. So that's what where I'm starting, and the reason I'm doing this is because I want to get future research funding, of course. I'm doing this on my own, in my own time, in my little shed at the bottom of the garden. But what we want to do is be able to add the objective measures of performance. And one of the problems with those measures is they don't, they work very, very well on a computer. You can even get them to work on a laptop. But what we want is to get them to work on a tablet or a smartphone. Okay. So one of the things we want to do is develop those measures for an app. Again, I am collaborating with my lovely mentor still, Professor Andrew Smith at Cardiff University. I spoke to him on Wednesday and he's very excited about the whole thing. There's a company that I've been in touch with as well called Druid, and they are in the United States, and they have already developed an app for measuring cognitive performance. The problem being that you can't, you know, it gives the participant the information, but it doesn't give anyone else the information. So it's getting the information off the app, which is a problem. And obviously involving the Long COVID Research Group and Involve as well. And that's going to be really exciting because it might lead to the fact that if this fatigue persists, then it might be the case that we might need to add some sort of cognitive behaviour therapy into that as well. And not just for COVID, by the by. I think that this could be generalised to people with underlying fatigue problems in different conditions. So it's not just a case of COVID, although we're more likely to get research funding for COVID at the moment, but it will be used as well in the future for others. So we're not just developing it for COVID, because we hope it ends at some point. In case you're interested, these are the papers that I actually cited in my talk. And so we've got the shift cold shift work and caffeine, the CFS and the DCD. And thank you very much. I'm glad I was eventually able to join you. Has anyone got any questions?
Oh, sorry. If nobody else has a question, I'll ask first. I was a little bit unclear about the graded exercise therapy you mentioned earlier. So is that treatment currently being used?
Until now. Well, NICE are no longer recommending it. So it was always used. It was a combination of, because what happens is the person with fatigue becomes physically deconditioned. Mm-hmm. So the graded exercise sounds a bit of a strange thing. They sometimes call it pacing as well. Is used to encourage the person using cognitive behavior therapy as well at the same time to overcome the negative thoughts about exercise and to try and build up their conditioning. So in the case of the study I spoke about that we used, that's why the physiotherapist who developed the whole thing, he did have obviously had a master's in cognitive behavior therapy as well, so he wasn't just pretending. But he would, you know, either take them out for walks and things like that, And also he used mindfulness meditation as well. I mean, a lot of stuff went in there. That's why it was called a multi-convergent approach. There was mindful meditation. They were given blood pressure monitors to make sure they didn't overdo things. There was a lot going on with that. But basically, graded exercises when you try to recondition someone. And the actual idea behind it, which sounds even worse, is it comes from Noakes's work, which is looking at the physical deconditioning in athletes. So if you remember, well, if anyone remembers, I can remember watching the Olympics and all that, people like Seb Coe and Steve Ovett and people like that were coming down with viruses, and then they were completely losing it in terms of their physical performance. And what they do is they strip them right back down to the start and then recondition them back up again. That's where the methods comes from, and that's where the theory comes from, and that's what he was using, but in a very holistic approach. So if a patient said, well, I just want to be able to go in the garden or walk the dog, there's no point in saying, well, you're going to be able to run around, the park. So it was very much an individually holistic approach, which you have to use for chronic fatigue, and that's why it's so expensive, and why it was never taken up, because it wasn't a batch one size fits all thing.
I see. Okay, thanks for that.
That was a long answer.
It explains a lot. Any other questions? Or you can type them in if you don't have a microphone, and I'll read them aloud.
Can I ask a quick question, Alex? It's Jermaine.
Of course, you can just ask.
Marie, just a quick one. Mm-hmm. So why did, in some of your earlier studies, you said about kind of subjecting participants to loads and loads and loads of tests. Why did you use so many rather than focusing on what previous research had suggested, like we would say to our students?
It was because at the time, they didn't know, no one knew what was going on. That was the problem. There wasn't any, what they didn't want to do was guess. It wasn't a very nice experience. They did do a lot of the tasks that I've explained previously, but it was because, as the Oxford group said, they really had no idea what the effects were and what was going on at all. No one had tried to try and quantify anything. It was just a case of trying to manage these people in primary care without having any idea about what the underlying processes were. So that was why the first phase was to do that, with the agreement of the whole team, obviously. It wasn't just a psychology decision, it was a medical decision, and the clinical, the scientists and everything, they were all with it. But it wasn't very nice to sit through, I've got to say. But we did produce a paper finding out whether their fatigue was on a continuum or not. But hey ho. But yeah, we did find out the ones that worked were more useful. And again, the aim of the whole process was, in terms of those evaluative things, which I didn't mention, sorry, I forgot, was to develop something that could be used in a clinical setting. So they could run these tasks and they could get an answer and then they could move on from there.
Okay, thanks.
Any more questions? We have a few more minutes if someone has a question. Maybe I'll ask another question if that's okay. I just wanted to know more about your thoughts on viruses in general and COVID in particular as causes of fatigue, if you wouldn't mind.
No.
Do you have any predictions about this virus being very different from other viruses? Or, yeah, it's kind of an open question, really.
Well, I mean, again, things I've missed out are things like how I didn't do in the psychology research unit, the health psychology research unit. So there was a lady, Sarah Hall. She was doing a PhD on glandular fever and the effect of that on cognition. And chronic fatigue syndrome was once called Epstein-Barr virus. They thought it was caused by the Epstein-Barr virus, which is the glandular fever virus. So, you know, and we know that, you know, influenza is a virus. So we know that, that we can measure these things in particular conditions. And we all know, we all experience post-viral fatigue. But as the chronic fatigue definition says, it can't go on for longer than 6 months. Once it goes on for longer than 6 months, as it can in glandular fever, for example, then you have to say something's now embedded itself into the sort of fatigue mechanism there. And we need to deal with that. You know, we can't just say, oh, don't worry, it'll get better in time. Don't worry, it'll get better in time. And I think what I think is going to be interesting is to see not only all the different demographics about the whole thing, but also the severity of the illness in, you know, in asymptomatic patients and things like that. Are the fatigue levels different? I mean, you would expect someone who's been on a ventilator to be fatigued, physically exhausted for a long time afterwards. So that's not going to be, you know, that's not going to be a surprise. You know, that's a horrible experience. But, you know, in the people who literally had the condition, had very few symptoms, you know, and carried on as normal, what's going on with them? Is that the same sort of thing, or are they a good degrees of impairment going on? So the aim is to go into a longitudinal study. Obviously, it's not going to stop like this. It's going to, you know, but for that, we're going to need more funding.
Oh, yeah, it sounds really fascinating, interesting. Thanks.
Thanks.
Any final questions? Oh, sorry.
It's 11 o'clock.
Ooh. Yeah. So I guess if not, thank you so much for the wonderful talk, Marie, and thank you all for participating. And hopefully there'll be a recorded version available quite soon. So bye.
Bye.